In Inferior by Design, Mersheimer wrote about what kind of concepts guide American decision-making in a context of bipolarity, why the context of bipolarity is particularly important, what options exist within a setting of unipolarity, and what are the costs of each of these choices we make. Realism in the 90s needs to say something about how the configuration of power in the system, marked by anarchy, is translated into concrete action and strategies on the part of states. So from this problem, we have three strands of realism. The first category is defensive realism. Defensive realism is closer to Walt because he is a very conservative author in terms of how he assumes states behave. Walt is an author very focused on the issue of survival as something that becomes decisive for any form of political organization within a context of anarchy marked by decentralization. Therefore, it is inevitable to think that given this degree of insecurity generated by decentralization, strategies reflect this need for survival. So what informs the rationality of the state's decision is, normally, a state supported by the search to safeguard its expectation of survival, which makes the state conservative from the point of view of its behavior, since it won't like to take risks. The tendency of the state is to pursue the status quo, which is why the balance of power becomes such an important concept. When a state is facing a context of change, it will give more importance to the power he already has than to take a risk that could make him gain more or lose everything. War always creates additional uncertainty, and states tend to be averse to these uncertainties. That's why they don't seek war. That's why they seek stability and why the status quo is important. The priority of the rationality of its strategy is more linked to maximizing its probability of survival and maximizing its power projection. Offensive realism. In offensive realism, to understand the international system, it is necessary to understand some things. It makes no sense to look at state strategies as if states were equal. To understand the dynamics of the system, it is necessary to understand the behavior of the powers of the system and not of all states in general. The rationality of the powers are different. Powers are less risk-averse, and because they are dealing with such potentially aggressive opponents in a changing landscape, if there is an opportunity to project power, you always grab the opportunity, even if it causes instability. This is because the power you fail to project today can be used against you in the future. To understand the dynamics of the system, it is necessary to understand the rationality of the powers, which is different from the rationality of other actors. And the rationality of stronger states tends to be more aggressive, because they play a more aggressive game. The possibility of power projection is seen as something that if we don't use that opportunity, even if it involves a risk, it can be used against you in the future. The rationality that guides the behavior is not the probability of survival, but the maximization of the projection of power. Any power you don't use can be used against you in the future. Neoclassical realism. Neoclassical realism seeks to argue that we have the structure that is the starting point for reflection on the international, supported by the idea of anarchy, decentralization, and distribution of capabilities. This structure is the independent variable of the system. This means that it is the fundamental cause of international phenomena. This structure causes the behavior of states. The behavior of states is the dependent variable. That's what you want to explain. You generate hypotheses to explain how the structure generates certain behaviors and not others. Between the system that is the independent variable and the behavior of the state, which is the dependent variable, we have the intervening variable in the middle. These are the processes that translate the constraints of the structure into the strategies of the states. These variables are, for example, geography, culture, history, a particular set of circumstances that will condition the way in which decision-making in a given state is supported by the power conditions present in the system. The materiality of the distribution of power is not enough to explain why we do A and fail to do B. For example, Americans do not react to a North Korean atomic bomb in the same way they react to a French-built atomic bomb. Even if the materiality, the components used in potentially destructive power are the same, there is a set of geographic, strategic, and cultural circumstances that condition how Americans translate that transformation in the balance of power into effective political action. The bomb produced by North Korea poses a more concrete threat to U.S. security than a French-built atomic bomb. We can only explain how the same deviation in the configuration of power, an independent variable, translates into different behaviors, a dependent variable, if we understand what's in the middle of the process, the intervening variable, the cultural, geographic processes that influence the construction of decision-making processes of certain states and how they react to certain changes. So these are the three main streams of contemporary realism. We have one with a greater focus on the status quo, and it looks at this property of the state to be very aware of its survival, and assumes that this is crucial for understanding the international system and this logic of preserving stability through construction of balance. We have authors who focus more on power politics and the particular circumstances of that policy and how it shapes the world as a whole in a more aggressive trend. Power needs a different behavior dynamic. It needs to project power whenever it has an opportunity. So it doesn't maximize the probability of survival. It maximizes the power projection. Finally, we have the authors who believe that in order to understand how the system's constraints translate into decision-making, it is not enough to generate a single hypothesis as the defensive and the offensive do. It is necessary to understand which variables intervene in the way constraints translate into decision-making. Therefore, it is necessary to understand what the intervening variables are in a given situation. Thank you for watching.